CBS presents this program in color.
From Television City in Hollywood.
The Red Skelton Away. Grab a rod and reel or gun tonight for a crazy trip we plan. And prepare to snare some fun tonight here in television land. If you wish, we can fish for some jokes a while, so folks will smile along.
If you're game, we can aim for a chance to do a dance or two and a song. Our guest
Thank you very much, and good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Oh, somebody got a sign out there that says, three signs, we like red. Thank you very much. That's very kind. Oh, guys. Yeah, I just got back from New York. I took two airplane trips to New York, my first and last. Hey, when I was in New York, I went up to the Macy's department store, and somebody recognized me. The next thing you know, hundreds of people around me, and then the squad cars came, and I didn't believe it. But it's the last time I ever steal a pocketbook. You know, I love to fly, though. I like to fly. It gives you a couple hours to talk to people while you're waiting for your luggage. You know, when I fly, I always fly, fly now and pay later. You know why? If anything happens to the airline, who do you think they're going to save first? I was telling my wife, Little Red, I said, you know, I'm a little suspicious about this airline. I'm not too sure about it because they got their tickets printed on a parachute. See, I wasn't too sure about the plane. And I'm not too sure about that joke now either. And you know, another thing made it look suspicious? They had a three-man flight crew. One of them was a priest. The clerk says to me, do you want to go by jet? Jet. You know what a jet is? That's something that moves ahead forward by hot air. You know what it is. You voted for him. But boy, this plane was really slow. Can you imagine how embarrassing it is to be flying 5,000 feet in the air and somebody wants pass and it's the flying nun? Hey, I was on an airplane once. I got the scare of my life. I'm on the plane and it says, a voice comes on. This is a recording. You're flying at 40,000 feet. You have no crew. You are being flown by automatic pilot. We assure you that everything is safe. Everything has been scientifically worked out, and nothing can go wrong. Go wrong. Go wrong. Airplanes are murder. They fly 30,000 feet in the air, and it affects your hearing, and they come around and give you chewing gum. I'll never do that again. It took me 3 days to get that stuff out of my ears. But we had a rough trip coming back on the plane. It was so rough that they were showing a John Wayne picture, and he stops his horse, gets off, and leans over and says to the lady in the front row, would you hand me that little container under the seat, please? Hey, there were two drunks at the airport. And one of them says, hey, did you know that our flight to the moon has been canceled? The other guy says, why, bad weather? He says, no, the moon is full. Oh. Hey, I got one for you. Two seagulls, Gertrude and Heathcliff. Gertrude and Heathcliff, they're talking. He says, I got a riddle for you. He says, what is it? He says, what is it that says, oh boy, oh boy, oh boy, oh boy, oh boy? I don't know. What is it that says, oh boy, oh boy, oh boy, oh boy, oh boy? He says, well, I'll tell you what it is. I says, oh boy, oh boy, oh boy, oh boy. It's, oh boy, oh boy. I'll have to do it again because I forgot the punchline. He says, I'll tell you what it is. It says, oh boy, oh boy, oh boy. He says, what? He says, it's a boy centipede watching a girl centipede in a miniskirt. I hope them two seagulls fly low someday in a boat. I won't give up. I got another one. I got another one. There's two seagulls are talking, Gertrude and Heathcliff. He says, did you hear about Peter the Rabbit? He went to see the dentist, but they wouldn't give him any Novocaine. He says, why wouldn't they give him any Novocaine? He says, because Peter Rabbit is an ether bunny. Hey, I'd like to do now, talking about the airports and stuff a few minutes ago, I'd like to show you different people at the airport. Have you ever noticed different people getting on airplanes? I'll show you. First, you have one of these guys. Those little things where you buy the insurance. One of these guys. And he's just the captain. Then the next guy coming in on an airplane. He's the navigator. Then you have this guy getting on the plane. He's the co-pilot. Hey, here's one for you. Here's a guy getting on an airplane. See, now this is not an embezzler. This is George Romney sneaking out of New Hampshire. Then you have a nervous fella on an airplane. Nervous fella. Thank you very much. A very, very nervous fella on an airplane.
Attention, attention, Miracle Airline passengers. Flight 22 now boarding at gate 1.
And now, ladies and gentlemen, our musical guest, Tom Jones.
It's happened all over our town. Tearing up the chicks with a message that he lays down. Who is the cool-ass guy? That is what I am. Fast talking, slow walking, good-looking, chicks are making reservations for his loving so fine. Screaming and fainting, he's got them all waiting in line. Who is the cool-ass guy? That is what I am. Fast talking, slow walking, good-looking, no ass am.
chicks are making reservations for his loving sofa. Screaming and fainting, he's got them all awake in line. Who is the cool-ass guy? That is what I am. Fast talking, slow walking, good-looking mohair Sam.
Ed Skelton as George Appleby and Mike Connors as Henry Pringle in Life, Liberty, and the Pursuit of George Appleby.
George, aren't you finished out in the kitchen yet?
Not yet. Yes. Now, why don't you buy an automatic garbage disposal?
Because that's what you are.
I know. I'm getting used to the watermelon rinds, but those chicken bones are sticking in my throat.
I'll do something about it.
I have. I already took 3 shots of Drano. And this afternoon, I'm sending for the Roto-Rooter man.
Here, George, I want you to clean this room. And don't be afraid to pick things up and dust underneath them. George, how dare you dust me?
Well, I was very thoughtful. If I'd used a wet mop, you might have cut cold.
I was an idiot the day I married you.
That's when I found out about it.
You clean this room!
Oh, yeah. She'll never forget she was a whack. Never forget. Oh. Little here, little there, and away it goes. Hang up. There's nothing like a good house cleaner. And she is nothing like a good house cleaner. Boy, it's a good thing I ain't been drinking. I might have sunk that baby. Gotta clean up, company's coming. Gotta clean up, good company's coming. I clean up because company's coming. Well, where will we put the dirt? Where does every red-blooded American put the dirt? Good heavens, she's bugged the carpet.
George Appleby, you put that dirt back where it belongs.
Okay, open your mouth. Now, Claire, now take it easy with me today. I'm cleaning up around here, I'm doing my best, and I'd like to be in one piece when Henry gets here.
Oh, Henry, yeah, that's another thing. Why did you have to invite him here to the house?
Because I haven't seen him since we were in college together. And number 2, he was an old fraternity brother of mine.
Well, he's nothing but a pipsqueak, a miserable, scrawny, objectionable jerk.
Well, naturally, that was one of the requirements of our fraternity.
Think of it. How did I ever happen to date you?
Well, you were part of the initiation. You replaced the water torture. Now, if I know the writers on this show, that's Henry now.
I doubt it. He was never strong enough to push a door buzzer.
Henry Pringle!
Well, good morning, madam. Are you the lady of the house?
Henry, it's really you. It's
yes,
really
it is, Georgie
you.
Boy. Give me that old fraternity handshake. Yeah. Georgie, it's good to see you.
Yeah, it is.
You know, now I know why we didn't have any fun in college.
Why?
We were so busy shaking hands, we didn't have time for girls.
What do you two do now? Exchange fraternity pins?
Oh, Clara.
That's the
I'm looking
woman.
Forward to seeing you. My, you're beautiful.
She's beautiful?
Hey, what are you doing? What are you looking for?
Anybody thinks she's beautiful has got to have a seeing-eye dog.
Henry, how you've changed. I wouldn't even recognize you. Why, you're so filled out and so tall and handsome and debonair. What happened?
Well, I got speared by the White Knight. Listen, Claire, how about a nice big kiss for good old times, huh? Uh-huh. What do you say? Is it okay with you, George?
You're my friend. Anything good enough for me is good enough for you. It's okay if you've had your rabies shots.
Oh, yes, yes.
Yes, yes, yes. Oh, there's nothing like friendship.
Oh. Oh, I've forgotten what it was like to kiss a man.
Well, what do you think I am?
Give me a clue. Animal, vegetable, or mineral?
Mineral, because I had rocks in my head when I asked you to marry me. And I had to get stoned to go through with it.
You kids sure have a lot of fun together. You must get a big kick out of life.
Well, he had most of the life kicked out of him by the time I married him. But I'm trying to kick some of it back in.
Yeah, she's always punishing me for something I didn't do.
Oh, what didn't you do?
Stay single.
You know, Red, I was looking over
Red,
our...
George.
George, yes.
That's that other idiot that's been running around
here.
Yeah,
well, I was talking to him backstage. You know, I was looking through our old college book, and they've got you down on a debating team and as the boy most likely to. Oh.
Most likely to what?
Well, that's what the debate was about.
Tell me, Henry, what kind of work are you in?
Well, I'm a stockbroker, and I'd sure like to sell you some securities, George.
Oh, no, thank you, Henry. Thank you.
No, come on. Now, really, I've got some pretty good stuff. I'd really like to sell you some stocks.
No.
Wouldn't you like to put a little money in some oil?
Oh, what good is slippery money? No, I've got $25,000 in my savings account, and that's good enough for me.
But is it good enough for Clara?
What do you mean?
Now, wouldn't you want to leave her with enough money so she could marry somebody else if you die?
Don't tell me that they're going to let somebody out of the funny farm just to marry her. And if you think they are, you belong in a rubber room yourself.
Now, George, Clara's a very desirable woman. Now, how do you know I haven't been waiting years for something to happen to you?
Boy, talk about ding-a-lings. He was a ding-a-ling in college, and the bell is still ringing.
To George. He'd avoid an accident just for spite.
Oh, you just say that. I married her. That's why she said that.
Oh, shut up and go out and get us some refreshments.
Now, that's no way to talk to me.
Get going or I'll belt you.
Now, that's the way to talk to me.
George, an awful lot, but I really love him very much.
Yeah, well,
and we're practically inseparable.
I'm sure you do. I'm sure if anybody wanted to find him, all I had to do was look under your thumb. Really, Claire, George should invest his money and try and make it grow. You know, if anything ever happens to him, $25,000 isn't going to go very far.
What's going to happen to George?
Do you realize how many accidents happen in a home every year? Why, he could trip at the top step, fall down, and break his neck.
That's true, I guess. Or I could drop his radio into his tub, you know, while he's taking a bath, and he could become electrocuted.
Yeah. Or you could leave the gas heater on, and he could get asphyxiated.
You know, there are lots of ways, aren't there? I never thought about that. Why don't we talk more about it while I show you to your room? It's right over
here. Oh, sure, thank you. Here, let me get my bags.
Oh, no, I'll get them. Let me,
right.
Please, it's my pleasure.
Sure, thank you. I'd take one of those from you.
Huh?
I'd take one of those from you, but I don't want to throw you off balance.
No, it's all right,
Let me get the door.
Oh, no, please,
there you are. Do you realize how many people die every year from choking on chicken bones?
Well. I'll tell you, she's lost the best garbage disposal she ever had. I could never believe it, that my own wife planning with my fraternity brother to bump me off. They're planning on getting married and using my funeral for the honeymoon. Well, I'm heading for the hills. That's right, heading for the hills.
George, where are you going?
Oh, I thought I'd take a little trip.
A trip wonderful idea. We can all go on a camping trip.
No, me.
You always loved to camp out, didn't
you?
Oh,
now that sounds great. As a matter of fact, I brought my gun. I can go hunting.
Oh?
Say, what's in season around here?
It looks like I am.
Claire, I got the feeling that George didn't really want to come along when we had the time behind that car. And I think he'd been drinking, too. He had to stagger the last 20 miles.
He has been acting jerkier than usual. And all those silly excuses he's been coming with to get out of here.
Yeah.
Oh. Oh.
Well, the folks holding the picnic over there are having a lot of fun, aren't they?
What happened, George?
Oh, I sprained my ankle. I gotta walk this way to the doctor.
How were you walking before?
Oh, I ain't walked like this before. Say, this open air sure cures you quick, don't it, huh? Say, I've got to cut out of here because I don't want to get caught in a rainstorm. I guess.
Hold it. Huh? Now, now, you know it's not going to rain here. As a matter of fact, I'll get the radio and see if we can get a weather report.
Oh, weather report. Why don't you just ask Claire what the weather is? There's some guy calls the house all the time and says the coast's clear.
Maybe we can get the same guy on the radio.
Yeah, right.
And now we interrupt our musical program to bring you a bulletin. Heather Van Buskirk, the West Covina housewife, has just been declared innocent of the murder of her husband. She announces she will marry her stockbroker and make their home in South America.
How about that? It's amazing what you can get away with these days.
Yeah, you know, yeah. I've always wanted to live in South America.
Yeah, yeah, I can imagine. Just, I'll be right there. I'll be right there.
George, who are you talking to?
Oh, Smokey the Bear. He wants me to help him stamp out some forest fire. He's got blisters. I gotta help him.
George, there is no fire around here.
Yeah, I'll start one. I'll start one.
George, you're acting wackier than a goony bird. Now, either you scream... What is that?
I think it's the iron in my blood. See, I eat a lot of pork and I'm full of pig iron. That's what it is.
Oh, now, George, why are you wearing a suit of armor?
Because if I wore a dress of armor, people would talk.
Now, you look like a fat sardine with a housing shortage.
George, take off that silly thing.
Right, my iron bread basket. Oh, you better call the police. I think my liver just broke through my rib cage here.
George, I said to take it off.
No, I need it. I need
it. What for?
Well, it protects me from the mosquitoes.
Oh, come on. There aren't any mosquitoes within 30 miles of this place.
See how well it works? Well, here comes a mosquito now. Here comes a mosquito now. If they can ever get the machine started up, there's a mosquito coming.
There he is now.
Oh, look, Bindi's beak.
Yeah, never knew what hit him, the poor little guy. Huh? Never knew what hit him.
Never knew what hit him. Oh, here comes another one. Oh, they say only the lady mosquito bites, but the one that just bit me is no lady, I'll tell you.
Now, that's going to teach you, George, never to buy a suit of armor without a pair of pants.
Yeah,
well, I'm going down to the lake and do some fishing.
Well, remember now, you can't swim, so find a nice deep spot. You're going to go fishing. You got worms?
No, but I'm going anyway.
What'd you say? What did you say?
I tried to hop on the camera.
Say, George, wait a minute, yeah, George. Yeah, you seem awfully upset. I'm going to have a talk with Claire.
Oh?
Yeah. Now, why don't you have a snort?
Okay.
No. A snort of this.
Oh?
Yeah, now you'll feel no pain. In the meantime, I'm going hunting.
Okay. If you see a rabbit around there with a derby, don't shoot him because it'll be me. And I'm an ether bunny. He's probably going to sneak around the back and shoot me in the back. That's what he's going to do. Well, here's one for the road. Let's hope it leads upward. Poison. I'll bet you a dollar that's poison.
Well, that's either poison or he drinks 300-proof tequila, I'll tell you that. Well, maybe I'm already dead. Maybe I've already gone to heaven. There's an angel if I ever saw one. Look at that wing spread. Let's hear it for Monroe High, folks. Tell me, who are you?
I'm a counselor from the boys' camp down the road.
Really?
I'm an outdoor girl.
Oh, wow, I see. Well, the part you keep indoors ain't bad either, you know. What does the M stand for, I hope?
Oh, it's the name of our camp. Mikanakawa.
Mini-did-what?
It's an Indian word meaning, I'll be down to meet you in your teepee, honey.
Hakabula-bula-wiki.
What does that mean?
Better be ready about 8:30.
You know, I've been around little boys for so long, I've forgotten what a real man looks like.
Oh, they're tall like this, and they use aftershaving.
I like you. If I knew you better, I'd just give you a real big kiss.
I'm George.
I'm Alice.
Talk to each other. You know, this may not win an Emmy Award, but it's great writing, folks. Great. Wait a minute. When they went out, you came in. How do I know you're not a booby trap? You might be wearing poison lipstick.
You must be some kind of a kook. You ought to be ashamed of yourself trying to pick up a defenseless girl in the woods.
Boy, I'll tell you, a walk like that could start a campfire. Well, it's better than rubbing two Boy Scouts together, I guess. I'm dying. I bleed. I'm dying. I'm dying.
George, the only thing dying is your acting.
Yeah. Clara, don't forget to feed the canary, will you? And take the turtle for a walk every night. Let him walk sideways. He thinks he's a crab. And give my old suit to the Salvation Army. They'll appreciate it. What do you mean? That's where I got it.
George, will you cut it out? You haven't been shot.
Then how come I'm dying?
George, if you keep this up, I'm going to shoot you myself. And what's this about he and I running off together?
You mean you two are not planning to knock me off and then live happy ever after?
Well, what are you talking about, George? Clara loves you. She just bought $10,000 worth of stock for me with her own money. Now, if anything happens to her, it's all yours.
Oh, really? Oh, Claire, will you forgive me for what I was thinking about thinking you were thinking?
Sure, George.
Now, look, why don't you two just kiss and kind of make up, huh?
After what just happened, don't get sickening, buddy.
Well, now that that's all settled, what are we going to do to have some fun?
Oh, well, we could go down the...
Take the gun, I'm gonna go start a forest fire.
Wagon ho! Our guest tonight is the star of the popular cops and robbers program, Mannix. And this guy has spent more time investigating the underground than a gopher has looking for a wife. Here he is, ladies and gentlemen, Mike Connors. Mike Connors. Hey. Fine boy, boy.
Thank you. Yeah. Thank you, Red. Turn around. Hands up.
What are you doing here? Look, this is a television show, not a Swedish movie.
I'm sorry. I got that habit playing private detectives.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I frisk everybody.
You do? Ever thought about making a picture with Sophia Loren?
Well, I never frisk ladies, Red.
Oh, you don't?
No,
why
no.
not? You don't know.
Well, I'm a lieutenant, not a captain.
Hey, let me ask something. When you play a serious part like you play, do you ever go out and really do investigating on your own?
Oh, sure. Yeah, I was just doing a little investigating backstage.
Really?
Yeah, I left my dressing room to go up to the water cooler to get a drink, and yes. I passed the girl dancer's dressing room. The door was open.
Oh.
Yeah, when I came back, the door was still open.
Yes.
So I went back to get another drink of water. The door was open. Came back, the door was still open. You know, Red, I never drank so much water in all my life.
Hey, have you ever made any strange arrests?
Oh, yeah. You know, there's one girl that's been arrested 18 times.
Really?
Yeah, she keeps going around with nothing on but a bikini.
Really?
Yeah. I had to arrest her this afternoon.
You did?
Didn't want to. But it was my turn.
Can you look at anybody and tell what they've been doing?
Why, sure.
You can,
Let's see now.
All right.
Ah, you got dust on your knees. You've been in a crap game.
No. I've been praying for a laugh.
Look, now, while you're down there, would you mind praying for one for me?
All right, I'll do that for you right now.
Aha! Uh-huh.
Ho-ho! Ho-ho! Hee! Sounds like the words to a protest song. What
is it? No, there's one thing I can tell you.
What's that?
We're now about to do those one-minute blackout sketches.
Oh, yes. How did you ever know that?
Well, I tell you, I can tell by your nostrils quivering because that cue card girl's about ready.
Okay, so am I. Let's get going.
Let's do it.
We'll be right back.
Dr. Livingston, I presume.
That's pretty good presuming, because I am Dr. Livingston.
Stanley's my name.
Ah.
For years, I've been looking all over, searching high and low for Africa for you.
High, low?
Yeah.
Well, I'll tell you, I have to speed it up. We have some patients here. We've had a very bad epidemic around here.
Oh, really?
Oh, yeah.
Yes, well, I'd like to take you back to England.
You want to take me back to England? Don't be ridiculous. I don't make house calls.
It's amazing, sir, how you, a nearsighted fisherman, catches the largest fish in the world.
Oh, well, it's nothing, sir. Nothing at all, really.
You're talking to the reel. I'm over here.
Oh, there you are, sir. Say, you've lost a lot of weight. You must eat better.
No. That's the pencil. Now,
I'm sorry. Yes, I suppose you want to see my catch.
Oh, I'd like to see the fish, if you don't mind.
Fish? Oh, yes, here we go. Ah, let's get this out of the way.
Oh.
Now, you see, this is a swordfish. I caught it off the coast of Mexico.
Oh.
Yeah, and this is a sailfish I caught off the coast of Hawaii.
Is that a sailfish?
Oh, yes. You see, it says right here, a sail marked down to $3.95. Oh. Now, this fish here I caught off the coast of Catalina, I don't really know what it is.
Oh, yeah.
I've been, She just swallowed a little too much smoke. Anybody around here know how to give mouth-to-mouth resuscitation?
Oh, yes, I know how to give mouth-to-mouth resuscitation. I'll volunteer, sir.
Yeah, well, I'll take care of this one. You take care of the other one.
Yeah, choke you miserable. All right, man. It's the most important game of the season. They're out there waiting for you. I want you to be proud of yourselves. I want you to make school proud of you. I want your parents to be proud of you. I want to be proud of you. I want you to go out there and really be proud. And when this whistle blows, get out there and give them everything you got. Okay.
Now the Silent Spot, starring Red Skelton. Tonight, Red shows you the trials and tribulations of a guy with car trouble.
Hey,
Is again, Red Skelton.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is our last show of the season, but thanks to your loyalty to our sponsors and their products, we will return again next fall. In a few seconds, you will see a list of credits. These are more than just people who are members of my staff. These are my friends who have dedicated their talents to help a man fulfill a belief that he was put here for one purpose. That's to try and make people laugh. So until we meet again, I'll say goodbye for now, and may God bless. Thank you.
Since our time is shot, we'll disappear till another week rolls by. 'Cause the network wants us out of here. They've got other fish to fry. See you all again. To our friends near and far, fare thee well, au
Art Gilmore speaking.